honest, the poem project is what I thought was going to take the longest to complete. Eventually, I was able to get it up within basically the first week of what I have designated to mark a Nights Unite month. So this time for the finale, I'm going to do something a little bit different. Now, if you are a regular viewer of this channel and reference me with auto racing, then you will know that the top 10 countdown has become a popular thing. Well, for this one, I don't have 10 subjects technically, so we're going to do a top 5 countdown. Now, how does this tie into Tomarken Nights Unite month? Well, it's pretty simple. Most of you know that Peter Tomarken's most known game show is Pressure Luck. However, he has hosted 6 different game shows. So to do something similar with the channel of Wrestling with Regret did with Bad Kane storylines, I'm going to make a little bit of an unpredictable countdown and see how many of these shows you remember. This is Top 5 Countdown. Peter Tomarken Game Shows. Other than Pressure Luck.
Is this magnificent hand-painted grandfather clock a bargain at $1,587? Would you pay $265 for these elegant contemporary fashions? Is this beautiful amethyst and diamond ring a bargain at $1,207? We'll be checking them out and much more on Bargain Hunters! And now, here's the man with today's Carnival of Bargains, your bargainer host, Peter Tomarken!
Thank you. Hey, all for me, how nice.
Alright, let me start off by saying that not all of Peter's shows were gems. This would be the ultimate exception to the rule. This show is called Bargain Hunters. And it is honestly one of the most WTF game shows I've ever seen in my life. Now, if you go on YouTube and search up the game shows that Tomarken has hosted one way or another, you will know that there are a bunch of pilots. How did this one get beyond the pilot is beyond me. Because Bargain Hunters, I have to be honest, is pretty bad. So here is the concept of Bargain Hunters. You have 3 different sets of 2 contestants having 3 different challenges. The first set of the contestants had a one-on-one bargain quiz. Basically, it's a yes or no question talking about an item and a random price, and you have to guess whether it was a bargain or not. The first one to get 3 correct answers wins. Okay. The second set of contestants, they have 5 items. You have to pick 2 in hopes if you don't pick the one that is not a bargain. And in the case you have a tie is settled basically similar to that of the Newlywed Game when they have a tie at the end of their game. The closest one to the right separation price of the product that was not a bargain comes closest, they win. The third set of the 2 contestants are shown 5 different items throughout the entire country. And what happens is they have to pick 3 random amounts, one of them being the actual amount sold in a particular store somewhere in the United States. And the first 1 to 3 wins. And then, in the final round, the 3 winners of each of those rounds basically have to pick a bunch of items that they believed are way below their actual price. The big bargains. And whoever has the biggest amount of bargains at the end of the game wins a grand prize. It sounds pretty weird in itself, since you have 3 different things going on, and then the 3 different game winners go to a final round. Wait, that sounds familiar. It's like if you have 3 people picked to do something, and then after they get done with 3 different things, there's eventually some sort of, I don't know, a showdown. Oh wait, this is the first half of The Price is Right. And there's actually more similarities to The Price is Right than you know. You have three games and then a showcase showdown. Tomarken has a Barker-like entrance. And the worst part is, it's not just The Price is Right. They also mimic, of all things, QVC. You know, that network that shows you stuff and says, buy your stuff, you got this on sale for such and such. Yeah. Because they have the dumbest sound effect to indicate, after the end of a round, a bargain item that you can purchase from your home for a bargain price by calling this 1-800-something number.
You into buying something, but here's Dean to tell you about our first goodie. Lay it on him, Dean.
You got it, Peter. Here's another opportunity you don't want to miss. An elegant 14-karat gold solid rope bracelet. For just $40, this popular 7-inch rope design bracelet weighs almost 1.5 grams, item number VH523. You can have this 14-karat gold bracelet not for the retail price of $55, but for only $40 plus shipping and handling. Don't miss out on this great offer. Have your credit card ready and call us right now.
Use The Price is Right with QVC. Good lord. And there's also a few more problems. To try and make the show look a little more flashy, for whatever reason, they put in a bunch of balloons. What is the point of the balloons? Are the balloons on a bargain? I don't know. And also, whoever the announcer is, obviously does not know the name Tomarken well enough to pronounce that particular name, because every time we get off a commercial, the guy has to end the commercial with...
And now back to Bargain Hunters and Peter.
Thank you, Dean.
And now back to Peter.
Thank you, Dean.
And now back to Bargain Hunters and Peter.
All right. Make my day. Bye, Jake. You done buying it? What the heck?
And this is how bad Bargain Hunters really is. According to a popular legend, Tomarken himself was interviewed about the show, and he literally called it, and I quote, a piece of shit. If you managed to get Peter Tomarken to cuss out the show, it was a pretty bad show. Even if he hosted it. You know what? I'm actually kind of surprised that Game Show Garbage has not done a video on this yet. I have to recheck their website to see if they've done a Game Show Garbage introduction for it, but if they haven't, I recommend Bargain Hunters, because if the host cussed out the show, it must have been a pretty bad show. And especially if it was Peter Tomarken! Let's get on to some good games from him, shall we?
Here for more Prime Games, more game shows, and more games of live interactive fun.
Okay, a lot of people are kind of either or with this particular show. A lot of people call the show Decades, but basically its actual title was Prime Games. If you remember Quiz Nation or Play Mania from about a decade ago, Prime Games was basically that, just with actual game shows in between them. It was like a commercial-like thing. And Decades was one of the games that was played on the show. It was GSN's first attempt of being, like what you remember Quiz Nation or Play Mania for. There was also a few other shows that were similar to that. Probably one of the most known being GSN Live. Anyway, there were a few games that are associated with this particular show. One was Decades, one was Race for the Numbers, and I believe another one was called Trivia Trek, which I have seen footage of him with. But when you actually look up Decades or Prime Games, you're more than likely to encounter only two videos. And basically, you see nothing relative to it, because apparently one of them was a pilot for the Decades game that was done at the set for Wheel of Fortune. And that was pretty interesting. And I don't know how they managed to pull that off, but I do remember seeing a video of Pat Sajak doing a GSN-like promo, so I guess that was the exchange for that. And basically, well, let's put it this way. This is how basically the game worked. Deck Ace was played with two players, playing one at a time. Each player had 30 seconds to get the most correct answers. Basically, Peter would read a question and then reveal three possible deck aids. The players using their phones would press a button on their keypad corresponding to the deck aid. The player with the most points wins. As for Race for the Numbers, it was also played with two players, again, each playing one at a time. It had a similar format, but each player had 30 seconds to get the most answers, Peter reads a question, and then three possible choices. And once again, they will have to use their phones to type in the correct answer. However, some of the questions did have two-digit answers. And once again, the player with the most points wins. Basically, it had a few different formats in terms of that, but there's not much known internet-wise about these particular ones. Trivia Track was a horse race-like one that had some pretty interesting things going on. But other than that, Prime Games was basically the first attempt at what is known today for most people as Quiz Nation or Playmania or GSN Live, which was pretty interesting in itself. It was the original format of that show, and it wasn't crazy, weird-like, like Bargain Hunters was, that's why I put it higher, but believe me, the other three shows is well worthy of being higher. However, when you do look for videos related to that, you do see this.
And we're going to play another Decades game, live, interactive, and free. I'll tell you what, I'm going to let Charlie intro some folks to us. I'm going to go over, and I'm going to spin the wheel. We're going to see what happens. Yo, Charlie, give it to us.
Don't touch that wheel.
I don't know whose idea it was for Tomarken dancing to be the intro, but thank you for that video. I'm really going to enjoy that.
About the first step to being a star and Winston Churchill's to win $10,000 in cash if you were a contestant on Hitman. And now here's the host of Hitman, Peter Tomarken.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to Hitman. You know what we're going to do? We're going to make the introduction on another subject, actually two of them. Just like you did last time, and we found out that when whales stay underwater for more than 40 minutes, they're just like you and me. They drown. We have more of those where that came from, so stick with us.
Let's go back to the very first game show that Peter ever hosted, Hitman. This was a pretty interesting game show that was on NBC for a little bit. And what ended up happening is that, well, it had its own uniqueness to itself. Basically, this is how Hitman is done. You have three contestants in the first round. Peter tells a story. The contestants must answer questions about the story. Kind of like the final round of the show Cram. The first two to get six questions right will cross the finish line, and then gets the chance to do battle with the champion. In addition, first place gets $300 and second place gets $200. In the second round, which is totally different from the first, the champion and the two winners gets to hear another story from Peter. And then the Hitman round really goes to the extreme. Pun intended. Anyway, what happens is the champion gets 7 Hitman. The first place race finisher gets 4, and the second place finisher gets 3. Knockouts occur by answering questions about Peter's story. If the champion knocks out all of the challenger's hitmen, the champion wins. If all the champion's hitmen are knocked out, the challenger who hits the final blow becomes the new champion. Which is kind of weird, but okay, that makes sense. But there's even more. The champion eventually does the Triple Crown. What you have to do in the Triple Crown round is fill three columns with a random amount of questions. Some goes to one, some goes all the way up to five. And this is how the board is set.
Let's set the board.
Okay, so Deoxys is a fan of the show. Anyway, in the bonus round, if you fill in one column, you get $1,000. If you fill in two, you get $2,000. But if you manage to fill in three, you win $10,000. Unfortunately, Hitman did not last long despite the neat concept, and it ended in a pretty memorable way. I will show you the entire thing and not just Rod Roddy's memorable quote. Because Peter's exit is very memorable.
If you would like to be a contestant on Hitman, forget it! And now, back to Peter Tomarken!
Thank you, Rod. Let me explain what Rod just said. This is our last show on Hitman, and we want to thank you for watching. Unfortunately, there just weren't enough of you. We tried to do something a little bit different here. And at the end of our show, if you laughed a little and picked up a little knowledge, well, along the way, then we feel we did our job. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank those who made Hitman possible, the people behind the cameras who often go unmentioned. First and foremost, our creator and executive producer, Jay Walford. Jay, I just want to thank you, and I want you to know that I'm very proud to have been associated with Hitman. I'd also like to thank the producers, Randy Neese and Roger Speakman, our associate producers, Stacey Babbitt and Joel Huck, of course, my partner in crime, our announcer, Rod Roddy, and, of course, Kyle Katz. And last, but far from least, our director in the booth, John Dorsey, the Fox. On behalf of all of us at Hitman, thank you for watching, and goodbye!
With you. I had a very, very rough time picking between these last two shows. One of them is a very awesome concept. Another one was pretty cool and has a connection to me because I saw it in my childhood. I was 9 years old when the show came on. So trying to pick between these two shows was supremely difficult. It was so difficult I had to rely on my pros and cons chart to decide between the two which one was the better show, because I literally could not pick. But eventually, after doing my pros and cons chart and having a basic score of 7 more pro things to 4, this is the show that ends up number 2 on this countdown.
Live coast to coast, America plays Paranoia. You're playing from satellite cameras in living rooms around the country. You're connected by internet and by telephone. You're all battling one studio contestant. Paranoia, it starts now.
The show is called Paranoia. It is one of the shows that was spawned after the success of Regis Philbin's Who Wants to Be a Millionaire. It is one of two game shows that Fox ended up having to basically show off to try and garner ratings for the game show world, along with Chuck Woolery's Greed. Anyway, Paranoia was a very cool set, and basically it was, for some reason, relegated to Fox Family, which luckily I had because it was literally an awesome show. Basically, here is the concept for Paranoia. It's an interactive game show, so you know it was going to be pretty cool. And it was, even though it lasted about 12 episodes. What happens is the in-studio contestant starts with $10,000 right in front of him or her. Three challengers via satellite play along. Hint, hint, The Rock. Peter will ask up to 10 multiple choice questions. If the in-studio contestant gets a question wrong, that person loses $1,000. Also, the in-studio contestant must challenge at least one of the challengers after each question. If the challenger got the question right, the challenger gets $1,000 from the in-studio contestant. If the challenger gets it wrong, the challenger gets a strike. Two strikes and the challenger is eliminated. But he or she gets to keep the money that he won. If the challenger won no money, then he or she would get $500 for playing the game. In addition, there is a couple other factors that can help the in-studio contestant for a little bit of money. One of them being the swap-out card. For $1,000, the in-studio contestant can swap a challenger for another awaiting challenger chosen by the internet. And keep in mind, this is 2000, so... There's also the knockout card. For $3,000, the in-studio contestant can eliminate a challenger, which has come in pretty handy in a few episodes. Also during the game is the interactive jackpot, which is set at $5,000. People on the phone and Paranoia's website, which doesn't work anymore, believe me, can also affect the game with the interactive jackpot that starts at $5,000. If a person gets a question right over the phone or on the internet, that person gets $50 and reduces the amount from the interactive jackpot for the player, the in-studio contestant, at the end of the game. If the in-studio contestant beats all the challengers, the in-studio contestant goes to the final round. If the in-studio contestant loses, he or she gets $500 for playing the game. If and when we get to the final round, if the in-studio contestant won the game, the in-studio contestant can pick one subject out of 10. 9 of the subjects have a times 10 multiplier with his or her amount. One of them has a times 100 multiplier, which apparently was hit only once. If the in-studio contestant has 15 seconds to think of the answer to the question. If the in-studio contestant gets it right, he or she gets the big money. If they get it wrong, he or she keeps what they already has. And also, to make them paranoid, his or her heart is hooked up to a heart monitor and you can hear their heartbeat. Now that's for the main stuff, but there are also side games. Also within the show, an internet player and a phone player both get the chance to answer one question from Peter, and their prize is an E-Machines computer with an Intel Pentium 3 processor and an Intel PC camera. Which for an internet player would be an awkward prize. You're on the computer, you answer a question on a computer. You win a computer! Okay? But I can see where they were going with a possible update. And there's also... This show was very cool, because to a 9-year-old, the set is pretty awesome. Of course, I found out via a report from Inside Edition after the incident that it was actually a green screen.
Okay.
Works for me. And also, since it was a live television show, you're obviously going to be prone to some bloopers.
Hey, that's it for tonight. We're going to come back tomorrow night and play some more Paranoia with more satellite folks and everybody up there. So, and until then, Peter Tomarken saying, get in the game. See, it's live television, Paranoia. I wasn't kidding. I was going to leave and just see if anybody noticed. But we're back. We're going to play some more. I was halfway in the parking lot and said goodnight. Here's your first question. Set on a world... I need the right question, please. Okay, they're just setting this back up here. This is called live television, folks. This is what happens when you're live. Now I'll do my two-step. There it is. Okay, ready for question one. If you were throwing a party and wanted to make guacamole, what would you need to buy?
I think I'm going to swap Dan out.
Going to swap Dan out. Okay, what, I need $1,000. Dan, look at that face. Such a little face. Dan, don't cry. I hate to see a grown man cry. You're so smart, she's gonna swap you out, but you keep the $3,000.
So Peter, I've had a great time. Thank you.
Oh, it was great having you with us. You take care, Dan. Bye-bye.
I will. Bye.
All right. Dan's gone. And what's happening is the internet folks, once again, have helped us decide on a swap-out player. Another player out of the pool come up against you. Now, you don't know if you're going to get a college professor.
Right.
Or if you're getting somebody that was a high school dropout, you just don't know. So you could do better, you could do worse. Should we go meet and find out who that satellite player is? Let's go right now and find out
who it is. And it's, well, that's, that looks to me a lot like, looks like a lot like Saxon,
hi,
Texas.
Dan.
Dan, how you doing? You're back. Yeah.
This plot?
Well, there's Eric in Pennsylvania.
I made it.
You made it. And let's see, who do we got there in cyberspace? Audrey from Silverdale, Washington. Hiya, Audrey. How you doing? She's typing away. Yeah, extremely wild. And are you ready to win a computer as well as a camera? Ready, willing, and able. Okay, Audrey, answer this correctly, and you got it. Good luck. What city was declared the first capital of the United States? Okay, hold on a second. We'll get it. We'll get the question back. We're going to get it back. Okay, I'll tell you what. What we did, we lost the question for a second. Okay, what? I'll tell you, we're going to come right back with you, Audrey. Hang on a second. We'll be back in a few moments. Stay with us. We're going to play another game of Paranoia live. Hang on. Hey, everybody. Welcome back to Paranoia Live, coast to coast on this Saturday night. And when I say live, you just had an example of live television. But we're back. We're gonna deal with that little internet situation up there and give our player another opportunity to win an e-computer with the Intel Pentium 2 processor as well as the PC camera. And let's say hello to her once again. It is Aubrey. I'm glad we did it again. Aubrey from Silverdale, Washington. And Aubrey, how are you doing once again? Yeah, it is very wild. Absolutely. It's live. And are you ready to win the computer and the camera? Okay. She's still ready, willing, and able. All right, Aubrey, answer this correctly, and you win them both. Good luck. What city was declared the first capital of the United States in 1789? A, Philadelphia, B, New York, C, Washington, or D, Boston? Take a few seconds, Aubrey, and then give me your answer. You say A, Philadelphia? Sorry, the correct answer is B, New York. But you got in the game. That's what's important. I thank you for playing, and you keep playing here on Paranoia.
Now, the reason Paranoia was big to me is because there were a lot of different game shows that came on in the 2000 after The Success of Who Wants to Be a Millionaire. Millionaire, along with Paranoia, Maury Povich's 21, and Dick Clark's Winning Lions were the big shows for me. Yeah, Greed had a little success with Chuck Woolery, but even though I did watch a lot of it, it still wasn't my cup of tea compared to the other shows. Fast-paced, interesting, good music, and the only thing good about Greed's music in my book was the Terminator music. But still, all of that stuff and then some. And Paranoia was definitely a very cool show. It was actually my first experience with Peter Tomarken, because I only found out about Pressure Luck a year later. And that's when I discovered the rest of his history. But Paranoia was a very cool show for me. And I don't know why I remember this. And I was 9 years old when it happened. I remember that when Paranoia's last episode ended, Peter was very emotional about it. And I'm hoping that if somebody out there actually has a tape of Paranoia's last episode and has that last bit where Peter made that speech that was so emotional, and at the time I didn't know why, but I obviously do now. I'm hoping that if someone out there has it, they can upload it to the internet so everyone can see it, because that'll be so neat for me to see that again. But anyway, Paranoia was a very neat show, had a very cool set that was on a green screen. It makes me think, now, how... when an error on the computer happened, how does Peter know that I'm having a green screen there? On his monitor, I kind of get, but... Anyway, it was pretty interesting. And considering how masterful Peter is, I can see why the people of Paranoia hired him. And it was a very neat show. It was my first experience with him on a show. And it was definitely one of those pretty neat shows, and I honestly wish it lasted longer than it did. I kind of believe two things. A, if it was on Fox instead of Fox Family, it definitely would have lasted longer, because you would have more variety out there, because I don't know what Fox Family's thing was at the time in terms of viewers compared to regular Fox, but I do believe that it would have lasted longer. And I also also believe that if the show was revived today, it could definitely do pretty well. The only problem is, who are you going to find that has the personality factors of Peter Tomarken to match the original show's intensity? I don't know. But anyway, this was a very neat show. But when it came down to it, there was actually one Tomarken show, not named Pressure Luck, that actually beat it. Sorry to say. But it is a good show.
From Paramount Studios in Hollywood, it's television's most exciting new game, Wipeout! And here to pit their knowledge and strategy against the Wipeout are John Bankel, Donna Eaton, Cynthia DeLois, and the one who fares best could drive off in this Beretta GT. And now, ladies and gentlemen, here's your host, the star of Wipeout, Peter Tomarken!
Thank you. Thank you. Hey, thank you very much, Bob Ridgely. Hi, everybody, and welcome to Wipeout.
Okay, intriguing beginning with Peter doing the announcing for himself. But anyway, the number one Tomarken game show not named Pressure Luck was Wipeout. And no, it's not the Wipeout from 2008. This Wipeout was a little bit different. What ends up happening with this particular show is that there are three different rounds, and there's a bunch of intriguing similarities to a bunch of other shows, but this show gelled together so well, it even outdid Paranoia in my mind. Basically, this is how the show went.
Let's look at the old board, shall we? There it is, 16 answers up there, 11 correct. Five are wrong. Your job? I'll tell you your job. It's to find the 11 correct answers, with the first one worth $25. Then it goes to $50. Third correct answer, $75. And so on until that final correct answer, the 11th, which is worth $275. And that means strategy in terms of playing the game, okay?
I'm going to try the Fandango.
Try the Fandango.
A wrong answer institutes a wipeout.
Oh, no. But you and I could do the Fandango out here if we had the band. It's a dance. In any event, no dollars, and over to Cynthia with $450. Four correct answers left out of six. Pretty good odds. It's worth $200 if you're right.
Okay. I'll take the Bushmaster.
All right. We'll find out about the Bushmaster. I don't know if you're going to want to take the Bushmaster. That's a snake. I doubt you'll want that. And hi, welcome to Wipeout, gang.
I'm going to start with her debut in the Seven-Year Itch.
Debut in Seven-Year Itch. Let's find out. She had small parts earlier, was not a debut, has one whammy. Whammy, I finally said it. I knew I would say it. It's all right. I feel better that it's out of my system. It's gone. And now do you want to press your luck or do you want to move on? Now I get it all out of my system.
Two players with the highest cash total moves on to round two. And they also keep the cash they win in that round. In the second round, there are 12 items on the board, 8 of them correct. You have to bid to say how many you know without wiping out. The bid winner then tries to get them all. If a wipeout occurs, the second player can get one guess to get the board. And the first player to two boards wins. The final round is also pretty interesting, as you'll see here.
I will demonstrate it for you. Let's see what they gave me today. They always like to have fun. The famous dwarfs. There are 12 up there. I'm going to want to pick the 6 I think are correct. I do that by touching the rim around the screen of each of the ones I think are correct. So, I would go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 7 won't light up, only 6. So I get back over here to the red button as fast as I can. Give it a hit-a-roo and see what I got. I got 4 correct, so I'm going to want to make changes in order to get to 6. Now, what's key is that in order to select something new, I have to turn something off first. So I have to turn Sassy off before I can turn Sneezy on. Kind of kinky, but that's life. Anyway, I'll come back here and see if that made a change. And I went from 4 to 5. Eventually, I would get to 6, but by then, that car would be a year old. We don't want that to happen. So we're going to give you a brand new board, all your very own. That's the kind of people we are. And we're going to give you 60 seconds within which to do your board.
So basically, you have 12 items on the board. You have to get all 6 to win the grand prize as a car. Get the 6 to 60 seconds, you win. If you don't win, you hear this weird sound.
1, now 2. You had a lot of back and forth.
Got a kind of a rut there. Let's take a look at the actual rodents, if you don't mind. A cavy, a lemming, a beaver, a prairie dog, a porcupine, and a marmot.
But to me, this is definitely a pretty interesting concept of a show. It's more flowable than all the others, especially Bargain Hunters. And basically, it has a bunch of intriguing similarities to me between Pressure Luck and Hitman, which works because the common denominator is Peter Tomarken, who hosted all three shows. So basically, Wipeout having the energetic flow that it has, the nostalgia flashback things, despite being from 1988, where Pressure Luck and Hitman was also in the 80s, and also being an original concept-like show, basically makes this one of the coolest shows and probably underestimated game shows that you could probably find. I enjoyed watching the Wipeout episodes that I did, and those were the episodes that told me, along with my pros and cons thing, that Wipeout was the best Tomarken game show other than Pressure Luck. So, now I ask you guys the question. What do you think of all the shows that Peter has hosted throughout his illustrious career in the game show world? What do you think of these other five shows that he's not necessarily known for in terms of comparison to Pressure Luck, but are pretty neat in their own special way, excluding Bargain Hunters? I thank you guys for enjoying this series. I am so glad that you guys were able to get involved with Tomarken Nights Unite Month. It is so awesome to see the connections between my YouTubian buddies and the game show world, and not necessarily the auto racing aspect of it. I really enjoyed doing Tomarken Nights Unite Month. It was a big deal to me. I don't know if it was a big deal to you, but it was to me. And that's one of my main things. It was so neat and so awesome to do this particular project. I learned a lot of things that I did not think I would learn. And also revisited a few things that I didn't think I'd see. And maybe in the future I get to see more of these intriguing concept shows on YouTube. Because it would be really neat to do that. But anyway, thank you guys for enjoying this video. And thank you for celebrating Tomarken Nights Unite Month. Yeah. I got a minor hiccup, and that's why all that weird stuff is happening. But anyway, thank you so much for celebrating this special month with me. It is a big deal for me. And maybe next time we won't wait so long for another one of my game show videos. And I'm also expecting Game Show Garbage to do a Bargain Hunters video. Because if they haven't done one now, it's well worth it. Because that show's just there. But if you can find episodes of Wipeout and Paranoia, also enjoy those shows. Because those are definitely the big ones for me. And also Hitman, because it was the first game show Peter hosted, and it was pretty neat. But anyway, thank you for enjoying the video. Thank you for celebrating Tomarken Nights Unite Month. And thank you, Peter. We still miss you even after a decade. This is Ultimate 23 Dragon, and that's my final answer.
Stop. The whammy has about 46 Flacati rugs now.